The link for the source code for this project is down below. And if you haven't watched the first video in the series that explains what's going on here, there's a link in the top right. But let's get into it. So here we have the README for this game. At the top is a list of concepts I think would be useful to have a basic understanding of before looking at the source code, such as an understanding of how GameMaker itself works, particularly how the sprite, object, and room editors work, how objects work, functions and alarms work, and so on. But as the note says, you don't necessarily need to know all of these things. I just think you'll probably get more out of the game's code if you do. Next, we have a list of questions you could look into if you want. The idea here is to give you a starting point, again, if you want it. All of this is optional, but for example, this allows you to download the game, open it up, and immediately focus on examining a specific element of code instead of wondering what you should look at first. Although there is also value in that. And after the list of questions, I have a list of suggestions for things you could try to change, grouped roughly by difficulty, although difficulty is subjective, so don't be surprised if something I called easy turns out to be hard, and vice versa. There are two things in this game that I want to go over specifically, so that you're not jumping in completely blind. The first is a high-level overview of the game structure. The game itself has an initiation state, and it goes from there into the main menu. Once in the main menu, it can go into gameplay, and from inside of gameplay, it can go back to the main menu or restart the gameplay loop. This game is simple enough that each of these states is controlled and represented by a single room. There is an initialization room, a main menu, and the level itself. I recommend looking at each room in depth, but for this video, I'm only going to look at the level. You can see some things I've placed directly in the room editor, such as the player and some starting clouds, but none of the obstacles, the things that you jump over, are here yet. They, along with additional clouds and the ground as it scrolls along, these are also objects, are all being created through code. The obstacles and the clouds we're creating with two spawners, which you can see here. The ground pieces are actually replacing themselves when destroyed. You can also see that we have a gameplay manager. I use a gameplay manager to handle things that are specific to gameplay, but not the entire game. In this case, I use it primarily to handle the transition to the game over state, along with updating and displaying the current score variable. The second thing I want to go over is inheritance. I use inheritance in a couple places, and I want to cover one set of parent and children so that you have a framework for thinking about inheritance yourself, just in case you don't have that already. Here I have the main button parent. The button parent has four events, which will be inherited by its children. These events deal with mouse interactions, which I want every child to have. Then each distinct button in the game is a child of button parent. Each child has their own create event, where the function that they want to run when they are interacted with is declared. The start button also has some additional events so that you can interact with it using the keyboard. If we were to diagram this inheritance structure, we could have our button parent up here with its interaction events. Each child inherits those events, but then in their own create event, define what they want to happen when that interaction occurs. And they also get their own sprite. The start button then adds some additional functionality as well, so you can interact with it using the keyboard. Two last things. The first is that 99% of the code in this game is in objects, and about 1% of the code is in the rooms, where I might set object variables or things related to the image, such as image scale or starting index. I purposefully did not use anything else so that the complexity would stay low, which brings me to the second thing that I wanted to point out. For the most part, I tried to use ideal coding practices, but in a few cases, I sacrificed ideal practices for simplicity. For example, I avoided scripts and method variables whenever possible for this game, even though I probably would have had more if I were doing it just for myself. But again, I wanted to keep the complexity of this source code as low as possible. So that's the first game. I really want to know what you guys think of this idea, so please let me know in the comments whether you like it, if you want more of these tiny games, if so, what genres you would be interested in, and of course, if you have any questions or comments about the code itself, let me know that too. And if you don't know how to get GameMaker source code from GitHub, I've got a 2-minute explanation in this video right here.